Hello, my name is CW4 Richard Dyke, commander of the Blue Devils Horse Platoon, 88th Regional Readiness Command, United States Army Reserve. Welcome to F Troop Season 2.
Hi, I'm Mike Teilman, Executive Director of the Bob Hope USO at Los Angeles International Airport. I also write and produce television specials. Speaking of television, one of my all-time favorite TV shows was F Troop. As a longtime Army officer on military duty during 1966, I know that F Troop was one of the favorite shows of our U.S. troops. This is a show that was created just to make you laugh, and that it did.
Well, I'm sorry, Chief, but we won't be needing those wedding rings after all.
What happened?
Well, we just decided that marriage is bad for horse soldiers.
Ain't exactly a million laughs for Indians either.
Sergeant O'Rourke?
Captain Prime Minister.
What are you doing here, sir?
I'd like to buy a ring.
Boy, did you come to the right place.
I like this one.
Oh, all right. Here you are, Chief.
Oh. You want change?
Yes, he does.
Captain, you bought Janie a wedding.
No. We're working up to that right now. I'm just buying her a friendship ring. Your right hand, Jane?
Oh, well, don't you worry, Janie. Just 7 more fingers to go and you'll be married.
Now, Sarge, that is the sweetest thing I have ever seen.
You know, it's interesting. Warner Brothers was one of the main studios producing that great staple for the American film audience, the Western. Warner Brothers produced some of the most memorable classic movies of all time, and they focused that same talent on television production. Shows such as Maverick, Cheyenne, Bronco, Sugarfoot, Colt 45, and Lawman, to mention a few. The pilot episode of F Troop was written by Seaman Jacobs and Ed James. In my opinion, the pilot of F Troop was nothing short of a classic TV Western comedy.
It was a lot of fun. I couldn't hardly wait to get to work to start laughing.
You know, F Troop attracted some of the greatest comedy writers of all time, without a doubt. However, it was difficult even for big-name writers to get an assignment writing an F-Troop episode. One of the great teams back then and to this day, Rocky and Irma Kalish, even had a tough time getting an assignment.
We had it in our head since we had seen the first season of F-Troop that that would be a good show to write, remember?
And they said, well, they said, all right, and we had a fight.
Yeah.
We had a fight to get in to get a hearing for a show idea. And I think at that time we came in with a show called Balloon.
Balloon. Yes.
Balloon. And we wrote the idea of it and we wrote the first script. And as they were reading the script, word came back to us that Warner Brothers was willing to make a full motion picture if we could have 4 more of the episodes of that particular script because they loved it. From that point on, we had carte blanche. Whatever we wanted to do on F Troop was ours to do. We ended up doing 8 of the shows and would have done more.
Many people will look at F Troop as just being this really enjoyable, funny, crazy, zany comedy. But you know, F Troop stories would also deal with situations that were reality based. Many of the show's writers crafted stories centered around military protocol and also featured situations that troops likely had gotten into.
I am a hunter of things at garage sales, and somewhere along the line, I picked up a book that probably cost me at least 10 cents. And it was an army manual that told everything from the Civil War days until the current time, which was in the 60s and 70s, about the army and the rules and regulations and what happened to people if they screwed up.
But the one story that really appealed to us was the story of how in the army, if a soldier lost a prisoner he was escorting, that he would have to serve the term of the prisoner. So that gave us an idea.
A wonderful idea.
And it became the script for the day they shot Agon.
We're shooting Agon.
Listen very carefully. Watch these episodes, because you're going to experience a very, very funny comedy, current even by today's standards.
We had more fun writing that show, and we were probably connected. Irma says 400 shows. I say 800 because we worked behind the scenes. We worked in different aspects of the business. But we had more fun writing F Troop than any show that we had worked on as many years as we had been in the business.
We love writing F Troop.
That was fun for us.
In 1965 to 67, when Vietnam was heating up, I know that the American servicemen could truly relate to F Troop. For them, it was sort of like a way to reconnect with home. And as you will see, the fact that it was a comedy really helped lighten the load with what was happening in Vietnam. You know, F Troop was so popular with our soldiers that there are studio photographs of Melody Patterson, who played Wrangler Jane on the show, with a member of the armed forces, and they were holding up these guidons that said F Troop.
We put up the sign F Troop, and we were eating sea rations, and we didn't quite have our feet on the ground yet. We weren't self-assured. And the colonel, the regimental commander, came out, and he saw the sign F Troop, and he says, "Wow, F Troop, where are the horses?" And I don't know what I said, but I said, "We ate them, sir." I said, "The food here is terrible." He said, "Aren't you getting hot chow?" I said, "No." And he said, "Well, we'll fix that." And we had Marmite cans every evening after that with hot chow. So F Troop got 9 Marines fed.
An interesting thing about F Troop, it was the Army, and it was making light of the military at a time when the action was becoming very serious overseas.
I went on active duty in 1965 with another service, and F Troop was, it was entertainment. It was a lighthearted look at soldiering in the old West to us. And when I hit Vietnam and went to my combined action platoon station, we were left out in the middle of nowhere, basically. And we all looked at each other, and the first thing that came to our mind was, "My God, we're an F Troop."
Whenever I discuss F Troop with people who are either in the military now or military veterans, they always look at me and smile a lot. I think because of two things. One is they could relate to it. Things that happened in F Troop actually happened to them when they were in the military. And two, the show was like a family thing to them. I mean, there were a lot of funny things that happened to them in the military. You know, we all tend to think that serving in the armed forces is all very stoic and no nonsense and yes, sir, no, sir. But also, there were a lot of light moments because servicemen and women are, after all, just people. F Troop is loaded with funny people that happen to be portraying life in the military.
Every unit in every service at every time had a Captain Parmenter. It had a Sergeant O'Rourke.
Action crew, fall out for cannon salute.
It had a Corporal Agarn.
"Oh, Cap, my Cap. He turned his brother into a crow. Now he's turned you into a chicken."
It had a trooper that couldn't blow his trumpet. It had a lookout that couldn't see.
Captain, sir, is that a friendly or unfriendly Indian?
Everyone in the services had that. It, at some time or another, each one of these characters has appeared in front of us, and maybe sometimes we were one of the characters. We just didn't want to admit it.
Let me see, Corporal. You have a statement of charges this month.
I know that, sir.
Last month you lost one blanket, one saddle, one bridle, four horseshoes, one horse.
Well, I have good news, sir. My horse Barney came home this morning.
Wonderful, Corporal. Was he wearing his blanket, saddle, bridle, and shoes?
No, sir. When he came back, he was stark naked.
An enlisted man joining the cavalry or the army back then was generally not viewed as a great step up in society. Soldiers were given very poor pay. Yes, it was a tough, dull life sometimes out on the prairie, but this allows the idea that there was indeed soldiers of competence who were out there. Just like today, the Army focuses on education and professionalism for its soldiers. After the Civil War, for about two decades, there was very little of that. And in that sense, there was not much given to them in terms of training.
All right, now pay attention. This is a head. This is a leg. This is a tail. And when you put them all together, it's a horse.
The troopers were notoriously bad marksmen.
Now, I realize we're all out of practice and a little bit rusty.
If we were any rustier, we'd have to get oil.
But some good intensive training should fix that up.
Ready! Aim! Fire!
Congress was not particularly thrilled about paying for lots of ammunition needed to train good marksmen. Thus, they got up to 10 rounds per month. That's not really enough to get a good marksman.
A lot of actors have interesting stories about how they wrangled an audition for a role or how they got the part in general. Ken Berry didn't come from a world of TV, music, variety, or comedy. He came direct from the military.
They had something called volunteering for induction, and that gave you the least amount of time that you could get, 2 years. And so I went into the Army and did my basic, and then I was in the artillery for the rest of the year. And then I got special services, and it was terrific. It was the best job you could have in the Army, you know, it was great fun. But the way I got it is we came back in out of the field, and, you know, we wore glasses when we were in convoy and had all this dust and dirt, and we were filthy. And the first sergeant said, by the way, they're having a talent contest over on the main post tonight at 7. That was only like a couple hours away. And the winner gets to go to New York and be on the Arlene Francis television show. And of course, that's for me, you know. And I went in and I grabbed my tap shoes, which I always kept with me, and a duffel bag, and my ukulele, and I knocked out a routine in the latrine.
Now watch. Da, da, da. Yum, bum, 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 bum. Now that's how you do the can-can.
Harmony, you're terrible.
You're right, Jane. I should kick a little higher.
Not what I meant.
I went down into the latrine and worked out a number, and I won that talent contest and then went up and met Arlene Francis and stayed a week in New York. It was great.
Captain, sir, I'm sorry, but we couldn't find him.
But I could.
Ken Berry was really a more modern actor because he came out of that school that was like, he did improv. He was an inventor of pieces of material and did it, and he would always be, we would enjoy it because we enjoyed the inventor, the inventions of things beyond the things that we put into a script.
One show that I directed, he had to do a thing where he's reading a letter and he's walking along and doing, stepping on these different things, and nothing's happening. He's just going right along as he reads this letter, and things are falling all around him and everything, and he's walking across planks and things. He could do all those things. Because he was such a good dancer.
We give the words to the actor and the scenes to the actor, and the actor has to take that and put leaves on the tree, on this trunk of the tree that we have established. And he was able to do that.
We were aware he was a good reactor too, and that is very important. So when we wrote a script like, I guess V is for Vampire, and we knew that we were gonna do shots of with this chicken under the hat, and he was gonna see his hat moving across the floor, we were gonna get a great reaction from him, which we did.
It was interesting that after F Troop ended its all-too-short run, Ken went on to become very well-known in a number of television series. He did Mayberry RFD. Basically, he was taking over for Andy Griffith, who was a TV icon. Then after that, he did, of course, Mama's Family for many, many years with Vicki Lawrence. Ken Berry had a terrific career. As far as I'm concerned, he's one of the great talents of all time.
Think Black Devil's still down in that canyon, Sarge?
Well, I'll take a look. Well, he's down there, all right.
Television was lucky to get an actor like Forrest Tucker working in that medium during the 60s. Really, Forrest was one of the people who helped catapult early television into episodic comedy.
Forrest Tucker, he looked like a John Wayne on a horse. They were both about the same size, and they rode so easy, you know, and I would sit in the saddle and I'd be bouncing up and down. I don't know how they do it, but he was really good at it.
Tuck could ride pretty good. Tuck was the best. None of the rest could ride at all.
When you watch Tucker on the screen, he had a bearing. He had a way of holding his back. He had a way of standing. And when you saw him ride, he could ride. And that was quite amazing, because when you watch some of the other actors, you know, their seats are terrible, their hands are terrible, their feet are stuck out. But Forrest Tucker sat a horse well. And so we researched him a little bit. And what we found out was in 1938, he actually joined the Army National Guard out of Washington, D.C., and was stationed at Fort Myer. Now, at that time, the commanding officer was Colonel George S. Patton, and the 3rd U.S. Cavalry was at Fort Myer. Forrest Tucker obviously served in the Horse Cavalry at Fort Myer, which was the showcase of the Army, still is. And he learned his craft well.
Hey, Garn, this is one of the best weeks the saloon ever had.
That just proves what happens when you have responsible management and a town full of heavy drinkers.
There we are. There's your share, and there's my share. we'll deposit this in the bank, all right?
We were living in Chicago. He was doing a radio morning show. And he said he was, you know, finished with Hollywood, except that he would come out and do guest shots. And while he was here doing the guest shots, he would tape little interviews with his friends and whatever and take them back for the radio show. He loved Chicago. He'd worked a lot in Chicago, and Chicago loved him. And he said, you know, this is where we're going to settle. Well, in bed one night, he got the script, and he was reading it, and he was laughing so hard, I thought he was going to fall out of bed. And he said, baby, gotta do it. Can't turn this down. And so we moved out here, and that was F Troop.
Among the guys who came in to read and audition on camera were Larry Storch and Forrest Tucker. And I've always been a great fan of Larry Storch's. He was a great comic.
You know, you look adorable in bangs. When Black Devil arrives, you let him think that he's sweeping you off your feet, and I'll be hiding him back at that rock over there, and when he comes up close to nuzzle you, I'll throw the rope around him. Now, you just be having a casual snack when he comes in. Of course, he is a big, good-looking thing, so you just be friendly and outgoing. And don't be forward. Men don't like aggressive women.
And then they said that they were going to also give Forrest Tucker a screen test. And I was really disappointed because I knew Tuck had this big, you know, he's a big Irishman and he fit the part perfectly, you know.
Threat! This engine killed the Colonel and Bandy!
Well, no. Me no.
See what you can do with the Colonel and Bandy and I'll go get Captain Parmiter.
And I thought Larry wasn't going to get it because Tuck was too big and powerful and he was too good. He's really good. And they felt the same way. So they gave each one of them a part, you know?
Larry and Tuck, they used to say they were attached at the hip. You know, they were always together. And then they went on to do a couple of other series together. They weren't like F Troop, but they tried to work together as much as they could.
Larry Storch was the funniest man I've ever been around in my life. He was a mimic. He could mimic anybody. He could mimic me. He could mimic anybody. He was just the funniest person I've ever been around. He had a great sense of humor.
Larry Storch was always impersonating everyone on the show. Everybody loved him. So the writers, being smart people that they are, took full advantage of his ample abilities. They'd write episodes where Larry was a Canadian fur trader in A Singing Monty. He was a German aide-de-camp in Bye Bye Balloon. He was also a Russian, and only one Russian is coming, only one Russian is coming.
I am here!
Storch was a brilliant mimic and comic. He was sort of like the United Nations of comedy. You know what's interesting about Melody Patterson? She was, in a sense, an icon back in the 60s. I'll tell you why. For young boys of that generation, she was their first crush. Here was this gorgeous girl who was kind of a tomboy, in a sense, like the girl next door, but in the Old West. Come to think of it, it wasn't just young boys that had a crush on her. A lot of soldiers thought of her as their girl back home.
Here we were shooting and treating her like an adult, and we had some other kids on the show one day, and this school teacher says, "What's she doing here without a school teacher?" So, well, she's 18 years old. She doesn't need a school teacher. So that's funny, because last year she was 15.
One of the things the producers of F Troop wanted was that Melody be a good horsewoman. Really. Wrangler Jane had to be a great horseback rider. Well, I understand that Melody had never ridden much before, so she went out and took a 1 or 2 week crash course in riding a horse. So when you watch the series, especially season 2, you'll see her riding a lot more, and she does ride very well.
Now, right over here, it's you can't miss it.
I used to work a lot at Warner's, and I was called in on an interview for F Troop, and so I had a cavalry hat on. I pulled it down over my head. They gave me a pair of granny glasses, and I was told if the pilot was made into a series, I'd be in the series.
Is there anyone here who has a musical background?
Me, sir.
All right, Vanderbilt, you try. What kind of a musical background did you have?
My sister played the violin.
Here's a great story about Joe Brooks, who played Trooper Vanderbilt. He was a huge Los Angeles Dodger fan, and he and a lot of the F Troop cast and crew used to go to Dodger Stadium to see the home games. And Joe showed how much he loved the Dodgers by bringing an army bugle with him. And during the seventh inning stretch at every Dodger game, Joe would stand up after everybody sang, he'd raise the horn to his lips and play, da-da-da-da-da-da, and the stadium's crowd would yell, "Charge!" Can you imagine Joe Brooks, Vanderbilt, blowing a bugle and thousands of fans yelling, "Charge!" What a great experience. It's interesting how F Troop dealt with Native Americans in each episode. You know, everybody was silly in F Troop. The troopers were funny and the Indians were funny. So it wasn't like one group of people were being made fun of. It was a fun-poking laugh fest for everyone involved. It's interesting that the Hikawis, the Indian tribe portrayed in F Troop, were never ever played by Native American actors. They were always played by top-name Jewish comedians such as Don Diamond.
Say please, me acting chief.
Or Italian comedians such as Frank Dacova. As a further example, guest stars such as Milton Berle played Wise Owl in The Great Troop Robbery.
Wise men say when shadow of wet bird fall on log, time out for beaver.
Phil Harris played Flaming Arrow in What Are You Doing After the Massacre?
Me still pinch squall, but me don't remember why.
During the mid-60s, you had all these great Jewish and Italian comedians play the Hikawi roles, as well as guest star roles. It wasn't a slap in the face to Native Americans. It simply was slapstick comedy. So they got some slapstick comedians to play the parts, and a lot of them were Jewish and Italian. It was just the way it was back then.
$0.02. I'm going to get some peppermint.
Help yourself, O'Rourke.
Janie, how much is this hat?
Darn.
Corporal, that's a very chic hat, but I'm afraid it's not regulation.
What are you going to do, join the Three Musketeers?
It's not for me.
That's a relief.
I'll give you 75 cents cash.
Sold.
The key to a good ensemble cast is chemistry, period. In F Troop, you can see that the cast loved working with each other. There's something about watching actors actually having a good time. It transcends the script and the TV show itself. It gets across to the viewer, and it makes everything much funnier.
Here comes the message.
What was the message?
No.
The great sitcoms and television have one thing in common. That is an eye-catching opening and theme song. For example, Gilligan's Island, The Brady Bunch, you know what I mean. And F Troop had one of the great ones.
The end of the Civil War was near when quite accidentally a hero who sneezed abruptly seized retreat and reversed it to victory. Medal of Honor pleased and thrilled his proud little family group. While pinning it on, some blood was spilled, and so it was planned he'd command F Troop, where Indian fights are colorful sights and nobody takes a lickin', where pale face and red skin both turn chicken. When thrilling and fighting get them down, they know their morale can't droop. As long as they all relax in town before they resume with a bang and a boom. F Troop!
F Troop used that opening in the first season. The second season, they didn't. So for the viewers who are watching season two of F Troop, may I suggest that you get the first season's DVDs. Watch some episodes. Watch the opening, because it'll tell you why F Troop became what it became, and then you can really enjoy season two. So there you have it. Fall in for F Troop.